Hi, everybody. Alan Arnette here. It is Tuesday, April 9th, 2024, and I'm thrilled to death to have something a little bit different than what I normally do on the podcast. I'd like to introduce you to Will Cockrell. Hey, Will.
Hey, Alan, how are you?
I'm doing great. Will is a journalist, and he has written he's a number of things, but he has recently written a book which will be released by Simon & Schuster next Tuesday entitled Everest Inc. Yeah, let that sink in. Everest Inc. So we're going to talk about the great industrial complex of guiding on Mount Everest. And basically, Will, your book kind of goes through the history of commercialization of Mount Everest, right?
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. It's a very kind of nice, finite chunk of time about the early 90s to today.
Cool. So, Will, just a brief introduction. On his website, he calls Everest Inc. a culmination of his career spent reporting on the tallest mountain in the world and those who climbed it. He's done a number of things. He started off thinking he wanted to be a mountain guide, living in the back of his truck and working. And then you had this epiphany, Will, decided that guiding was not going to be in your future.
It was hard. my hat goes off to mountain guides, the really good ones, to be honest, because as you know, it is like going to Harvard graduate school without really a paying job at the other end of it. And I just kind of like started to find interest in other things and things that required me to be in one place for a long time rather than traveling around.
Right, right. And you're born in Marin County, but now you live in the climbing mecca of East LA, West LA?
West LA, yeah. I live out near Malibu. And so
elevation zero.
Exactly. And which is why I probably surf a lot more these days than I do climb. But that said, this is the first time in my life that I, even though I grew up in California, that I have spent so much time in the Eastern Sierra. So strangely, when you're in Southern California, getting up to that 395 corridor up toward Mammoth, for some reason, is a little more accessible. So I find myself in the Eastern Sierra a lot more than I ever did. And I'm kind of getting back into stuff.
Uh-oh, be careful. It's a slippery slope.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, you're going to actually, get back into the big mountains again.
Yeah.
So your book, Everest Inc., so full disclosure, Will called me or contacted me probably over a year ago and said he had this idea for a book and that Simon & Schuster had expressed interest in it. And I love how you originally positioned it to me. You said, I sold it as it's the opposite of Into Thin Air.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
Almost kind of a antithesis of Into Thin Air in that, a couple things. I feel like for as great a journalist as John Krakauer is, I mean, I would say the trifecta. He's a great journalist. He's a great writer. And he's a great climber, to be honest.
Absolutely.
He's done. But I would contend that that John, he's a very, by all accounts, he's a very righteous man and has a very sort of strong sense of right and wrong in his eyes. And I think that as agendaless as he would say he went to that mountain in 1996, showed up just sort of ready to report on what he saw, I would contend, I don't know if he would agree with me, that part of what he was there to do is decide who belonged there and who didn't. Hmm. I think as a climber, I just think that was built into him of like, well, let me go see. And then slowly as we run through that cast of characters from 1996, you kind of get, I see. He's sizing each person up. Do they deserve to be here or not? Right. So he's building these characters in a way that's not wrong. It's good reporting. But Sandy Pittman, for example, each of these people gets characterized a certain way. And he doesn't come out and say this person doesn't deserve to be here. But I do think that if you read between the lines, that's what he's doing. He's saying this person, I'm not so sure deserves to be here. This person, I'm not so sure has put in the time or paid their dues. And I think I was trying to do the opposite of that, right? I was trying to say, First of all, explain how that's kind of a silly argument, in my opinion. I think it's a silly place to start, right? Of plopping yourself down in base camp and looking around and be like, well, who deserves to be here and who doesn't? You know, the Instagram influencer mother, whatever, who's never climbed a mountain and has trained for a year and ends up summiting, by the way, which happens a lot these days. I wouldn't dare say she didn't deserve to be there, even if she never climbs another mountain. And so I enjoyed approaching it from that perspective.
So in writing the book, you interviewed a ton of people, including me. Yeah, I'm gonna talk to you about how you portrayed me in the book later on. I got a bone to pick. So
Hey, if everybody loved the way they were portrayed, I wouldn't have been doing my job, right?
yeah, exactly. If everybody loves you, you're doing something wrong. First off, why did you even want to write this book? Because, we all know that Everest is the mountain that people love to hate. And it's sad to say, but I've been covering it now for close to 25 years. And I see all the jokes about helicopters and escalators and Starbucks and nobody deserves to be there. They paid their $65,000 and got short roped to the top by a Sherpa, and then they came home and told everybody how they did it all by themselves. And if somebody dies on Everest, it makes world news. If a 20-year-old who has dreamed of it in his life, or a 60-year-old dreamed of his entire life, he summits, accomplishes a dream. Nobody cares. Nobody listens. It's the old journalism. If it bleeds, it leads. So, I mean, this thing is somewhat the third rail of climbing, talking about Everest. If you Google number of books on Amazon about Everest, it's literally where Everest is mentioned. That's in the almost a million, much less hundreds and thousands. So to write a book like this, and to also looking at the guiding industry, there's some risk associated with that, as we jokingly said, but I don't think it's really a joke, that you're gonna probably not only anger, but isolate or some people that are saying, who are you? Who's this Cockrell guy who thinks he has the knowledge and the experience and the credibility to write a book like this? So let's start there. It's a little provocative, but how would you answer those critics about, why would you write a book, and who are you to write this book?
Well, to start, the last point you made, I may not be a good climber, and I probably can't climb Mount Everest like you did. I mean, that's why it's so impressive when I meet people who have. Maybe I could, but I don't know.
I was drugged to the top.
Right, of course. And so, but I am a good journalist. I mean, I've been doing it for an awful long time, and I look at it like making cabinets, and I've gotten good at making cabinets. And so, that's one thing where I feel confident. I talked to over 100 people. So I didn't need to know everything. I don't need to be the expert as long as I talk to the people who do know. And boy, I covered my bases there. And I'll go to this thing about where it all kind of began is I also said, does the world need another Everest book? I kind of, my instincts are no. And in magazine journalism, which is where I come from, funny enough, you're always looking for this counterintuitive angle. And then you just cross your fingers that it actually pans out or makes sense, right? So you look for like to say like Chef Gordon Ramsay is actually a really cuddly nice guy. You know what I mean? And you want that to be the headline, and then you kind of hope that if you spend some time with him, that's true. But often you need to bend it. Well, with Everest, I started thinking about how kind of misleading most of the information and the headlines were that we get, and we're just missing key pieces of information. And I started thinking of several events, right? I went back to 2019, the Conga line, and then before that, 2013, the fight, then into thin air. And I started stringing these together and thinking, wow, wait a minute, is it actually fair to say that all the reporting has sort of gotten it wrong? In other words, the Everest industry is not the dysfunctional mess that it's been portrayed to be. And then as I dug into it more, I was doing that thing where I was saying, but does this pan out? Can I really make that argument? And the more reporting I did, the more it was panning out. And it actually kind of was like this great discovery to say, wow, this is actually something that needs to be out there. Because when you look at it in its entirety, these 40 years, it's crazy not to look at it as a positive or interesting or fascinatingly, even uplifting story.
You could argue that the first commercialization of Everest was with David Breashears, big loss to the industry or community, his death here recently, with Dick Bass on the Seven Summits. And I think that's the first time that anybody thought about paying somebody. Before that, it was always national teams or the British Mountaineering Club or Alpine Club or something like that that went and climbed these big mountains. And then Breashears and Bass came along, and all of a sudden, oh yeah, I could get paid a lot of money for guiding this. And then, of course, Gary Ball and Rob Hall founded Adventure Consultants, and then the Mountain Madness with Scott Fisher. And then they went to Everest for a few years, and they kind of developed a formula, and all of a sudden it became a, you could see an Outside magazine on the very back, or go to Field and Stream, you would see a little ad in the very back of it, a 1 inch by 2 inch ad that says, "Climb the world's highest mountains with Adventure Consultants, $65,000 to climb Mount Everest," which I find amazing. They charged $65,000 in 1992, and today some of the companies are still charging $65,000. So somebody either is making a lot of money or not making money these days. Anyway, but how do you start off the book in terms of the initial genesis of commercialization of Mount Everest?
Right. Well, so there's a couple things there with the Dick Bass story. The more I learned about Dick through David Breashears, by the way, which was a big source for me. I had hours and hours of conversation with David,
Great.
who, even though he's never been a guide or a client, and he's never been involved in the commercial side of it, he actually was so instrumental in the sort of the development of the mountain around that time, and he knew all those people really well. But in talking to everybody and talking and hearing how strong of a climber Dick Bass was, hearing how he was, I mean, he was built for it, he was talented, he could have been, I think David Breashears says he could have been a world-class mountaineer if he wanted to. So to hear all those stories and the fact that, Dick Bass did not pay David Breashears, there wasn't really that guide relationship. I thought, well, what is the significance of Dick Bass then? He was a badass in the mountains. He didn't pay to go to the top, and his climb was quite hard and harrowing. So how does that make him the first guided person, or how did he kick this off? And the answer is that he was the first to come down off that mountain and shout from the rooftops that tenacity is what got him up, not skills or, the rest of it that comes with being a climber, a mountaineer. So Dick Bass was very proud of the fact that he was, I mean, I this is being a little bit simplistic, but that he was not a climber and he summited Mount Everest.
Right.
That was a profound moment for him, even though, yes, he was a climber, of course he was, because of what he'd done. But he used to make jokes about how the only time he ever exercised was running through airports, right? He liked to sort of make those kind of self-deprecating jokes, and I think that kicked off the era of this mountain is not just for climbers. And then in that second phase, I just want to say you're absolutely right. As depicted in Into Thin Air, Mountain Madness and Adventure Consultants were certainly sort of like, they were the ones that became, I guess, famous early on. But it's interesting because the overlooked story, and again, this was really fun to find, is that the first person to actually place an ad was Todd Burleson of Alpine Ascents International,
Interesting.
a kind of an unknown, a nobody in the climbing world, really. And that was 89, he placed that ad. And so technically, it was 1990 that Todd Burleson and Alpine Ascents International made the first guided climb on Mount Everest with some of the best guides out there, but no one summited.
Ah,
But
oh, okay.
that was the very first
Yeah.
commercial guided climb with amateurs and very experienced guides.
And that was Rob Hall's kind of Achilles heel, that he had had 100% success, no deaths, and just, I mean, literally just had a formula. And so in 96, he was following that same formula. And of course, we know what happened. But in the 90s, also, there were other names like Kerry Kobler out of Austria, and Eric Simonson out of International Mountain Guides. And so, there was really this cadre of people. Russell Bryce kind of came into the picture in the 90s. And so in my mind, the entire industry was built around this, kind of this constellation of guides that hired Sherpas. And at that time, most of the Sherpas had worked, I guess, a little bit for, national climbs. Of course, Tenzing with Hillary and all of that back, another 40 years earlier. But how did you characterize those early pioneers of guiding, the Hall and the Simonson and the Burleson? And how do you characterize, those guys and how the impact they had in the formation of the industry?
Right. Well, I go so far as to sort of tag them. I had to parse out who really were the most influential. And I refer to something in the book called the Big Five.
Ah.
And for me, the Big Five, it's Alpine Ascents International, founded by Todd Burleson. It's International Mountain Guides, IMG, founded by Eric Simonson, Himex, founded by Russell Bryce, Jagged Globe, which was earlier Himalayan Kingdoms, a UK company founded by Steve Bell. And where am I at? Is that four? And Adventure Consultants. I think that's the fifth. So Hall and Ball there, right? And they really had the biggest influence. And other than Himex, are all still on the mountain today. That is wild to me
That's amazing.
that they were there in the beginning. And then the one other interesting piece about what you just brought up is that I also was learning quickly that your cred in the Himalaya, or as a climber, or as a guide, or the amount of money you had, sort of didn't play as the biggest role in who got to the moon first, so to speak, right? I look at someone like Eric Simonson, who was probably the most serious Himalayan climber of all of those people. He probably had the most experience in the Himalaya. He was guiding on Rainier up and down that mountain, who knows how many times every year in
Right,
Denali.
right.
I'd say of anyone, like, he was the best positioned, and yet it took him a few years after Burleson and Adventure Consultants for IMG to get paying clients to get out to go over there and get them to the top.
Eric, really, I think he set a benchmark charging, I think it was around 35,000 back then. So, and he kind of played the quantity game over the I won't say the quality, because I think International Mountain Guides runs one of the highest quality trips. I've climbed with them. Again, full disclosure, I'm a big fan. But they have a I think what they have is one of the best values in the industry, and that remains today. While other people are at now 75 and 80,000, the Western outfits, he's like at 45, 49,000. So, again, big value there. Talk a little bit about, let's bring the Sherpas into this, because another thing about Everest is the mountain that people love to hate. Another one of the quips is that if it wasn't for the Sherpas and nobody would climb these mountains. Well, I'm not sure Reinhold Messner or Uli Steck would agree with that, but they would also, I think they'd be the first ones to say that the Sherpas have had a absolutely, they're a major piece of the overall puzzle. So in the early days, though, in your research, what role did the Sherpas play, let's say, in the 90s? Because we're gonna segue this in a few minutes into how the Nepali Sherpa-owned companies have come to dominate the commercial guiding today. So I think it's interesting to figure out where the Sherpas started and how they were positioned by the Simonsons and the Hall and Balls and the Cotters and others.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite parts of the Everest guiding story, really, is how that evolution happened. And it was actually a sticky one to handle early on in this period you're talking about, because I had to get to the bottom of why why this, I kind of knew it to not be true that it was simple. It was all the Sherpas doing everything and they're just hauling people up and whatever. I knew that wasn't true, but I needed to actually dive in and figure out, I needed to unpack it a bit. And thankfully, with some of the older experienced Sherpas like Funuru, who works for IMG, Lock Barita, who had worked for AAI for 30 years or something, they helped me understand actually that that quite simply they were not mountain guides. Mountain guides, their training is really all about is all about really is be knowing what to do when things go wrong. Okay. If you break a leg high on Everest or you fall in a crevasse, there's these complex rescue systems. And the Sherpas were not trained in any of those things. So the Sherpas were these crazy strong powerhouses who, you know, just genetically even had this advantage and could sort of stay clear-headed to the summit and be right by your side, but did not have the skills if things went wrong. And so that's why I believe that in the beginning, I don't, it's hard to say, but that's why in the beginning they got sort of stacked behind the guides in importance. And I think it's unfair to sort of cut, you know, to short shrift the guides and how that training that they had and what they were doing, you know, it's not colonialist to say that they, you know what I mean? They came over with a certain skill set that you really need on the summit or on the, you know, above Camp Four on Mount Everest, right? Beyond what the Sherpas had. And I would just say, I guess, like, you know, the reason why the Sherpas, however, were important during that era is you probably know this better than me, but like I don't know what percentage of mountaineering, say in the Himalaya on a mountain like that, is that siege mentality, right? I mean, the way we climb these mountains, most people, if you're not Reinhold Messner, is, you know, over a month or two with rotations and blah, blah,
Up
blah,
and
you know.
down, up and down.
Yeah, and that requires this big infrastructure. And Nepal was just very well placed with this local population to basically have cooks and shelter makers and all, you know, porters. And that's why it became so intertwined with the industry, in my opinion, is because that's how you have to climb those mountains or, you know.
Very interesting. The Sherpas really developed this partnership, I think, with the Western guides, and this is not insulting at all to anybody, but they became apprenticed to the professional guiding industry, and they learned from the professional guides, and it wasn't too long till the Sherpas, too long in relative history, that the Sherpas were now climbing for their own enjoyment. And climbing for the same reason that people like me or you go climb as well. And so they were no longer working Sherpas. They were now climbing Sherpas. And then they started moving into their own, starting their own companies. But before we get there though, if you look at the early 90s or early 2000s, all of a sudden now I've got tons of these graphs that, that show how many summits that there were. And, and interestingly enough, the percentage of deaths actually began to go down as a percentage of the people that summited. I know some people quibble with that metric. They won't talk about people above base camp and things like that, but it's the same end result, is that actually Everest became a very relatively safe mountain to climb. And part of this was this partnership between the Sherpas and the Western guides. Today, Everest has a death rate compared to summits of 3%. Whereas K2 and Annapurna and Nanga Parbat are, up around in the high teens now today. It was up in 30%, but even they've come down because of the same formula that companies are applying to the other 8,000 meter mountains. One more thing though about the how the Sherpas and the locals, if you look at Aconcagua, kind of something similar happened on Aconcagua. It was guided by foreigners, and now the local people guide more people in Aconcagua than any place else. Denali is probably the exception because of the way the National Park Service manages Denali, that you don't have that same Denali Inc. infant, well, maybe you do, but it's because of the concessions, it's really contained. So yeah. I think your point is really a good one, that Nepal was kind of well positioned, you know, kind of a perfect situation of the country, of course, the cachet of the world's highest mountain. You had the infrastructure by way of the Sherpas, and then you had the vision coming from, you know, the Koblers and the, you know, the Hollenballs and Gary, Scott Fisher and all the rest.
Yeah.
So now we, so the late 90s is where it kind of all began to get crystallized. And then we move into the early 2000s. From 2000 to 2010, I mean, it's just, you know, it's the curve just goes. It's, yeah. you know, it's almost like a straight line just going up every year, every year, every couple of bumps in a row. 2006, there were a lot of deaths. 2008, the Chinese stopped climbing on the Nepal side for the Olympics. But talk a little bit about that chapter in the history of Everest Inc. How did commercial guiding develop in that 10-year span from 2000, to, let's say, to 2013, which is when things really changed?
Yeah. What you mean sort of blew up is what you're talking about, that boom. Yeah. Yeah.
Blew up in a good way.
Yeah. All right, right. Well, for one, just to circle back to the Sherpas a little bit, you know, one thing that started happening relatively quickly was a lot of the companies they were working for were very, very keen to have them trained. So they were slowly being trained in these technical skills and gaining the same knowledge and skill sets that the Western guides were. It takes time, but it was happening, right? All of a sudden, these were no longer load carriers. And so that's one thing, right? You had that. So really, it's about the infrastructure. They basically built this really watertight infrastructure on Everest, kind of a formulaic way to climb this mountain. They feel like they had it down. And a lot of people point to the period you're talking about as one of the messiest or one of the ugliest or most dysfunctional because, or actually, you know what the word that, or the term that people throw around a lot is it was a circus, the Everest circus. That's probably the most common phrase that was used around that time. And, you know, I would say, you know, if you're being cynical, you can point to a lot of instances of ridiculousness on right. Everest around that time.
Right.
If you're being less cynical, I would say that it was a time of experimentation in the sense that a lot of these companies got so good at what they do. There was almost like a sense of like, wow, this is so good. We could invite just about anybody to climb this mountain.
No experience required.
And sure enough, they did. You know, it was very much like this badge of honor to say, you know, are you a high earning lawyer who wants to let off some steam? Come climb Mount Everest. And it's really easy to sort of like, I guess, take a shot at that. I understand that. But on the other hand, that was intentional. That wasn't like a mistake or a business error or a way, you know, or again, like we talked about, it wasn't greed, right? There's almost no money to be made.
It's a way of expanding the market.
Sure. And also there was a certain amount of pride among mountain guides that they're like, yeah, we've nailed this. We can get anyone up that mountain. That it was just kind of a mind-blowing idea that the mountain that was once impossible to climb.
So Will, was that arrogance or confidence? On the side of the guides and the operators?
Well, I think all people who run guiding companies on Everest and climb mountains like that, I think there's a lot of arrogance and I don't know, there's maybe some narcissism built into all that, but I think that's life. I think that's all of, you know, I think certainly being a journalist, you know, I check myself all the time. But I don't, that's human. I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all. And sure, some of them may have got over their skis a little bit. I do think that's possible. And of course, the criticism there would be, but when they get over their skis, people die. I think that's fair. I think that's fair to say that. But I think to say that's the rule is totally wrong. I think it's the exception that people made really grave bad errors of judgment, and got people killed. That's very much the exception on Everest. And I can't help but go back to, I've talked to so many guides now and tried to get into their head of why they do what they do for a living. And
Why do you do this?
yeah, well, right. Why didn't you become Conrad Anchor? Why didn't you go off and try to do cutting edge climbs and get recognition for doing crazier stuff and all this kind of thing? And these guides are built differently. They genuinely like taking people up the mountain over and over, but the best way it was put is it's the same mountain, but it's a different experience every time because I'm with different people. And to be witness to that transformation that mountains provide is a pretty powerful and special thing. And you don't take it lightly going into guiding. It's not like a summer job or a, it's a dedication that's like becoming a school teacher or something. And so, yeah, I mean, it's interesting to hear you use the word arrogance, but I do feel like at the time, like on Mount Rainier, it was like, wow, who can we take to the top of Mount Everest, the highest mountain in the world? It was a point of pride.
I like that. I like that. But they did, and like we both have used this word formula a couple of times, it is in fact a formula now. It's the same route. The camps are in the same place. They pretty much know when the weather windows are on Everest. Of course, a lot of things have really advanced over the last your horizon of a 30 or 40-year time. The technology, clothing, weather forecasting, knowledge of the route and the movement of the snow and the Khumbu icefall and things like that. But still, the unknown happens every year. And it culminates in things like last year when we had 18 people die on the mountain. 18 Everest climbers died on the mountain, the most in the history. And for me, that was a shocker. And maybe we'll save that discussion for the very end of this discussion. But so now we're kind of at the 2010. There's been this rampant growth, and the guides are saying, we've got this thing, we've got it. And so, and again, your big five are pretty much still around. There's a handful of other companies that have come in, but pretty much the Western companies are dominating it. By my research, 80% of the climbers who summited Everest, and let's just pick up anywhere in that time frame, but let's say 2011, 12, 13, 80% were guided by commercial companies like Adventure Consultants and Alpine Ascents and International Mountain Guides, people like that. And then you started to see something happen. In 2013, there was, in my opinion, that's when there was this inflection point. And it happened on, and a lot of people didn't really see this unless you're a nerd like me, maybe you. But now that on Manaslu, there was an avalanche that took out Camp 3, and it killed a high number of people, including a high number of Sherpas. And a couple of younger Sherpas in their 20s said, "Hey, enough is enough. We need to take control of this industry." And slowly but surely, this transformation began. And we started to see companies, in my mind, and you're the expert on this now by your research, that Seven Summits Treks and the brothers, they were climbing. They had summited all the 8,000 meter mountains. They had a name, they had some cachet, and they formed the company Seven Summits Treks. And take us from there.
So there's some pieces to this that I still don't fully understand. Trying to understand sort of the motivations of the Nepalis and the Sherpas and get deep into their culture, I would need another 10 years for that and maybe another book, right? So I don't want to pretend to be an expert on that culturally, but I will throw out some interesting questions, right? Like, so for one would be, you talked about the disproportionate number of Sherpas, say, getting killed, right? That was one thing that people started to question. But there was something else interesting happening among the Sherpas, which was this ire over a lack of recognition. And I'm really trying to get to the heart of that. There seemed to be a constant, drumbeat from the Nepalis who worked in that industry that, like, why is it that the Westerners get so many accolades and pats on the back for doing this.
Right.
This work we do on the mountain goes unnoticed. That just seemed to be like a central beef that the Sherpas had with the system, not with any one person. And it was brought up, for example, that, a Westerner would go home and everybody would, their Instagram followers would go through the roof. And this might be pre-Instagram, but, they would get a big pat on the back. They might even get like to be an ambassador for a gear company or something like that, just for having climbed Everest. And again, the Sherpas were just like, not, or a lot of guided climbers would go home and say, "I climbed Mount Everest," and imply they did it unguided. And I think, that's just a crummy human thing to do, right? That's just not a nice thing to do, I think, is to ignore, not recognize the role the Sherpas
Right,
play. Again, I think that's the exception, not the rule. So I think there was recognition was one part of it. The other part of it was a disproportionate amount of danger. But I would take a little bit of issue with the disproportionate amount of danger part. I hope I don't get in trouble for this one. You might be able to help me or bail me out, depending on where this goes. But if you look at a company like Seven Summit Treks, these were incredibly entrepreneurial Nepalese, these brothers who looked around, and I would almost say were the first ones to be brave enough to say, "Wait a minute, we can offer the whole package. We don't just have to be the assistant guides or the this or the, whatever. Why don't we just do it top from top down, top to bottom? We're the company. We have the porters, we have the guides, the whole deal." That was a big moment. That was a really big moment. And what I was going to say, I guess, sorry, I'm getting off track, but like the disproportionate number of deaths among Nepalese is that within the Seven Summit Trek system, the same exact thing is happening, right? They are putting Nepalese in who have to go up and down the ice fall over and over and porter stuff. And they're putting them in the same exact type of danger that the Western companies did. The
Right.
only difference is that the owner of the company is Nepali and making whatever owner money owners make. And the lead guide, right, who was once always a Westerner, is now a Nepali. Usually an incredibly talented and well-trained climber again, and they're making head guide money like the Westerners used to make. And it trickles down. The whole top end of the infrastructure is Nepali, and I think that's the difference. But there is still a lower end of things with the porters and the less experienced
Yeah.
Sherpas that are still being put into those positions by those companies.
So I think one of the big accelerators during this time was in 2014 when the Serac on the west shoulder of Everest released and it killed, I think it was 16 Sherpas in the ice fall. That's when you talk about the disproportionate danger. And that was solely because those Sherpas, they'll do 2, 3, 5, 10 times the number of trips through the icefall than someone like I will goes there as a commercial client. Another thing about the Seven Summits Trek, because that 2014 really, I think it pushed the creation of the Nepali guiding industry. But
Yeah.
another thing was, and this kind of goes to the last word in your Everest Inc. Incorporated. I mean, this is a business. Full
Yeah.
stop. It's a business. It's not a labor of passion to be a mountain guide. I mean, I think if we called up any mountain guide and said, let's compare your net worth to Elon Musk, they'd either hang up on us or just, laugh hysterically. The business model, though, the Nepalese, they had several advantages. One, they were not paying the same wages as a Western guide was making. Two, they weren't paying for travel. Three, they weren't paying the 8, 11, now $15,000 permit fee. And four, they typically didn't pay quite as high as the Western companies did. So their cost basis really went down, and that allowed them to come in and charge. Back in 2013, 14, 15, $25,000 instead of $65,000. $40,000, that's a car.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, that opened up a brand new market. I mean, think about Southwest Airlines and Ryanair and, other low-cost airlines. It's exactly the same analogy in the business model. It was the price elasticity curve that they were able to offer basically the same product, arguably. Now, people would argue that one all day long, but it's the same result of getting to the top of the world for half of the price. I mean, what could go wrong? Well, a lot could go wrong.
Right. And so it's interesting because, like, you bring up the Ryanair model or the budget airline model, right? I mean, there are dozens of people sitting in boardrooms literally saying, well, what if we moved the seats a quarter inch closer? Could we fit one more row in the back? Do you know what I mean? Like, that those are the kind of micro discussions they're having to squeeze out as much from one single flight. Let's start charging for the peanuts. Little things like this, right? Now, the problem is that's just business. That's smart business, right? That's how big companies like that thrive. The problem is obviously if you transfer that into the Everest business, it gets tricky because you start to say, what's the maximum number of clients we can send up with one Sherpa guide, one Nepali guide, and still stay in our preferred safety margins? That's a kind of a gray question, right? There's no black and white there. The Nepali government does have some of its like rules and restrictions around that, but it's not just the head guide, it's how many assistant climbing Sherpas there are there, ready to assist if something goes wrong. And that's the this is foreshadowing the growing pains that the Nepali companies are going to have over the next several years, in my opinion.
Yep, I agree.
I think that I leave off in the book with kind of a like uplifting note of, isn't this cool where it is? But as we saw last year with the death rate, and as we will see, a lot more, I think, are preventable deaths. Okay. And again, you better believe it's going to be another great opportunity for the New York Times and everybody to do like big articles about how messed up and dysfunctional and, amoral the Everest industry is. But again, I just think we're entering into a new period of growing pains, like the Westerners had early on, for more of the Nepalis now, where they're going to have to reconcile what they're comfortable with, right?
So yeah, I totally agree with that, and I think that we're in this going to come through an era of reckoning, the same way that era of reckoning was in the late 90s, especially after 1996, when the Western companies said, okay, we got to get our act together here. We can't just go run anybody up and down the mountain and just say, well, May 20th is my auspicious day, so we're going to go hell or high water, weather be damned. And well, that's what happens. And so, I mean, we're continuing to see, though, the same type of mistakes being made last year, last autumn on Manaslu, that every single Western company left. It was only the Nepalis were left because of the high snow and avalanche danger and people getting killed almost on a daily basis. So the risk tolerance is much, how would you say it? The Nepali companies have a higher risk tolerance. In other words, they're willing to take more risk where the Western companies are not. Now, is that cultural? Is that business? Is that arrogance? Is that confidence? Probably a little mixture of all of those. So let's use this to talk about kind of where the industry evolved then in the second half of, from let's say 2013 to pre-COVID to maybe 2019. So in my view, what happened was we saw this 80-20 just kind of shift, and all of a sudden you had 80% of the people that went to the top of Everest were guided by a Nepali company, and 20% were guided by your big five, where now it actually is like a big seven. And I want to talk about this as well as what happened to those big five, because all of a sudden they began to splinter. But kind of talk us through your view on that second half of of the 2000s there, in the 2013 to 20 to 19 pre-COVID. How did the industry evolve?
Well, one of the things that that makes it kind of seem like the evolution is obvious is the minute you visit the Khumbu. It's interesting. You've been there and you trek up that valley and you realize just how entrepreneurial and shrewd the Sherpa people are. That's aside from being an awesome, friendly, warm. I mean, there's so many great things. They're just so intelligent, and there's just like a way about them.
Absolutely.
That prosperity in the Khumbu was bound to trickle up, I guess is a good way to put it, right? And when you're running four lodges in the Khumbu, in several towns, like because you've built up to this point, it's inevitable that the next step is, well, wait a minute, I should also own the guiding company. Like just think of how much of a one-stop shop that is. You own the lodges, you hire the guides are in the valley, that you own the company, your headquarters is in Kathmandu. I mean, it really makes sense.
And I'm sharing with Asian trekking is kind of the gold standard there.
Yes, that's a great point. I mean, and yeah, you say on sharing. I also do you it's interesting to think I talked to Dawa Steven
Yes,
a
his
lot.
son.
I mean,
Yep.
yeah, I don't know, like between the two of them, who was guiding that more, but it definitely feels like Dawa Steven was like seeing an era where like, well, why can't we do this top to bottom? And maybe along with his father, they did that. Yeah, because right, 2008, wasn't that, didn't we sort of pin that down as like the first time a fully
Right.
Nepali-led guided
Yeah.
thing happened?
Yeah. To be fair, actually, Asian trekking predated Seven Summits Treks as
Yeah.
being a the dominant Nepali guide. So it was really
Exactly. They
Asian trekking. Yeah.
were the first, right? So but it's the scale, right?
Right.
Seven Summit Treks envisioned a scale that was as opposite from what the Westerners would be looking at as you can get.
Yeah, 100 clients versus 10 clients.
Yes, it was how many airplane seats can we fit in there and charge and make this kind of money. And the Westerners, of course, were their safety zone, their safety their place of comfort was to offer boutique type trips, right? The
Right.
smaller the better, high quality clients, huge margin for error. And so, yeah, that's just the different, it's a different business model. And we should also just, I guess, bring up the fact that in those price points as they changed and the switch from 80-20, the market changed a lot, right? Some of the biggest markets were now opening up were like India,
Right.
Malaysia, the Chinese, places where a middle class was emerging and they could afford these more affordable Everest expeditions. And this is something I'd be curious if you've heard the same thing, but my understanding was that Western interest was dropping off client-wise because the mountain was becoming less dangerous.
Well, as a if you look at it in raw numbers,
Yeah.
still Americans, Germans, Brits, are the top in the top five
Okay.
of clients on Everest. But what has changed is that the Chinese and Indians and Southeast Asia to a lesser extent are now in that top five where they weren't, let's say, 10 years ago. And that
Okay.
is because that number one, the Nepali guide companies have done an outstanding job. Like Climbaya has done an outstanding job of cultivating that relationship with the Chinese Tibetan Mountaineering Association. And these guys go to Beijing, they all do on a regular basis into Lhasa to cultivate that industry. I mean, they go to the trade shows and the travel shows and they develop this relationship. So they've done an outstanding job of so-called market development to bring in, this new middle class. And what's interesting to my mind is that what's happened is that you've seen this 80-20 thing. Now you've got companies that the Western companies, they're not competing on price. No, in fact, their
Oh.
prices are going up. It's now 75, you know, Freudenbach charges $100,000. Adrian Bollinger, Alpenglo, they charge, I think, 95,000 to go on the north side. And still, and the DePauli guys are now, they've gone up a little bit. They're 35 to 45, something like that, but they're still half. Mm-hmm. But what's different today is that the amenities, and I mean, and in some ways, they're over the top now. Massage tents, you know, they bring in a masseuse. They've got, you know, now, to be fair, Russell Bryce was the king of amenities. I mean, he was the first one with the big dome tent, and he had the espresso, and you know, they had wine with dinner and all of this stuff. But now the Western companies have, some of the Western companies, not all of them, have really just taken that and just upped the ante. To be fair, companies like Seven Summits Trex offer a VVIP service for $200,000, which they sell out every year.
Yeah.
And it's been, over the last 4 or 5 years, it's been three wealthy Chinese men who have paid $200K, and they go in with their, you know, the private Seven Summits Trek helicopter. They have, you know, multiple Sherpas with them, you know, unlimited satellite phone access, and on and on and on. But it, if you generalize it, really, now the Western companies are competing on amenities. And they still offer, you know, a climb, but higher levels of oxygen flow, more Sherpa support. Now it's not uncommon to have 2-to-1 Sherpas, and still the Nepali companies are doing pretty much the basics, but they're also, there's this luxury creep going up. And to many, that's the bane of the industry. And so I'm interested in what your perception was as you looked at the you know, kind of now from 2000 post COVID to today, 2024, I mean, where's the industry today, Will? I mean, where's Everest Inc. and the state of the industry?
Yeah, the amenities, that the things that you're talking about, they're really easy to make fun of. They're really easy to like take pot shots at and everything. Yeah. It's actually, you know, it's not the bane of the industry. It's the bane of climbers, or nostalgic, romantic climbers who
the old goats.
Yeah, who have an idea of what climbing a mountain is. And one of the most interesting things to me was even how nostalgic the clients of the 90s are for the way they did it. Yes. So, you know, you had this, like, you had real climbers who wouldn't hire a guide, who do it all through mentorship, looking their nose down at clients, right? You're and then right. Funny enough, you had clients from the 90s and the early 2000s looking their nose down at clients from now. And to be totally fair,
back in my day.
Yeah, exactly. And to be fair, the climb that was being guided in the 90s and early 2000s was way harder. Way harder than the climb today. Right. You know, just in terms of base camp amenities, oxygen flow, and this kind of stuff. So I get it. But the biggest, again, one of the biggest misconceptions about this industry is that people are or should be trying to maintain a certain sense of authenticity in climbing terms. Right. So, in other words, that's not what the industry is anymore. That's it's literally the goal of the industry is to get people to the top of the world by all means necessary and make sure no one dies. That is, and I guess you could go so far as to say, not unlike when the national park system sets up the infrastructure around the Grand Canyon. It's just like, how do we allow everyone in the country to come visit this thing and not fall off and die and be able to have a hot dog for lunch? Like that's, you know, it's really, you know, one of the natural wonders of our world. And that's how a lot of those are treated. And that's kind of how Everest is being built up. I mean, I know this is one of the hardest things. Because we can go on and on as climbers, it's sort of like you go to the mountains for solitude.
Right.
You go to the mountains to clear your head. You go to the mountains for new perspective, you know, and, you know, I hate to say it, but non-climbers are just like, whatever, you know, and again, I've always compared it to like doing an Ironman, you know, when some people decide they need to shake their life up a little bit and they decide that they're going to try to do or train for something they never thought was possible for them. An Ironman, for example, And you hear these stories that people do it, and it's amazing. And it wasn't about defying death for them.
Right, right.
It's just about doing something incredibly hard.
But, you know, the experience, though, today is drastically different. You know, when I first went to, trekked to Everest Base Camp in 1997, you know, helicopters were rare. You know, they didn't have movie night. You didn't have internet access, or you're in Wi-Fi over your 5G, or by that time, you know, 3G phone. Today at Everest Base Camp, they're trying to clamp down on it this year with yet another rule that won't be enforced, but is to have, you know, cut down the number of helicopters that can fly in. They had four pads last year. I don't know how many they'll have this year, but every team has movie night. And so you hear, you know, the movies blaring through speakers all throughout camp. You know, again, it's just the pure level of support and amenities and luxury is just kind of, you know, it's not the same experience. So in some ways, and I try desperately not to be that guy sitting on my front porch yelling at the kids to get off my lawn, because I completely, the thing that I celebrate that has been driven primarily by the Nepali companies is that they have opened up mountaineering to a whole new generation. And I mean, and I am 1,000% for the young people coming in and enjoying the same thing that I and you and others have. There's no reason. I mean, I reject this argument that, well, you shouldn't go climb that mountain because it's been climbed. No, I haven't climbed it.
Right. You just have your personal reasons for going to it.
Exactly. Precisely. Right. Which kind of brings me to a point as we begin to wrap up. All right. You take some pot shots at people like me.
Well, how?
Wait. I gotta have my say before you have
your
say.
Yeah, go for it. All right, here we go.
You know, as just like the Western companies kind of built and the Sherpa companies built, or the Western companies built their business on the backs of the Sherpas, and the Sherpa companies built their companies on the back of the Western companies, I would submit that both of them, all of them, built their business on the backs of people like me. Now, I'm not a professional climber. I consider myself I consider myself phenomenally lucky, and I'm extremely grateful, because I never would have been able to climb Everest, much less K2 or anything else, without the support of Sherpas. Kami Sherpa, he's my Nepali brother, always will be. I love him to death. And, you know, without people like Kami, people like me would not be able to climb these mountains. Full stop, full acknowledgement.
Yeah.
And also, these companies wouldn't be in business if it wasn't for people like me. But you kind of look at this, the commercial client, and you kind of profile me briefly in the book, and actually you do a really good job. Thank you. But talk a little bit about that, you know, the role of a person like me that played in the evolution of Everest Inc.
Yeah. Well, you can actually correct me if I'm wrong, but I think I actually portray the average client on Mount Everest throughout the decades. Once again, in a way that's never been done before, right? Because client climbers are probably the easiest to make fun of over the years. And it has happened time and time again. The person who puts their crampons on for the first time, it's always these little stories that get picked up that just like trying to let people know just how absurd people who go climb Everest are. But, you know, again, I was going to let the reporting take me where it took me. But in talking to people over and over and over, and the people I met personally and talked to about their experience going over there, Rebecca Ferry, you know, like these people who just like came from a different world, you know, the British Mama Five, who, you know, has now, I don't know how many 8,000ers she's climbed, but I just kept saying, wow, that's a really cool story, or that I really like that person, or, you know, I learned a lot from that person. And I just feel like time and time again, the average Everest climber, as a lot of the guides will say, are just people from all different backgrounds coming over there for all different reasons, and are usually pretty cool people who've bitten off something kind of insane, you know, and should be admired for even attempting it. And then, what happens is I think one of the most difficult problems on Everest, difficult problems to solve, are the assholes. You know, I think I even use that term. Excuse, pardon me, but I use that term in the book, which is that there's a lot of ego. People show up and they, you know, they're not nice to other expedition members. They don't pay attention. And the bottom line is they're not good members of the expedition.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's amplified when it's life or death.
Yeah, absolutely. Right?
Yeah. So that, I would say that exception is where we get that perception. But the bottom line is the majority of people going over there are quite remarkable.
it's similar to that, to the mainstream press, New York Times, Washington Post, BBC, they don't talk about Everest unless somebody dies. Similarly, that this guy who comes over there and is a jerk, you know, like that movie about K2, you know, that those jerks, they get a disproportionate amount of the publicity because they make for an interesting read. Because, you know, in journalism, as you know, if it bleeds, it leads, and you've got to have a villain in every story in order to make it interesting for people. And sadly, that tends to be human nature, I guess. Yeah. By the way, climbing the seven summits, that company, if you go to their website, they actually have a written no dicks allowed policy.
Yeah.
Dick headers, I mean, you know, they're kind of crude, yeah. but it goes exactly to your point, you know, because they want people to get along. They're not looking for the prima donnas.
Yeah. And you and I, for instance, we probably our reference point would be clients coming from the West. It's really hard to know what the Malaysian clients are like, or the China, you know, I don't know what their little subgroups of assholes are in those cultures, for instance, you know, but we here in the West, we certainly know those people that you're just like, oh God, it's too bad they've come along. There are a lot of instances of Western companies telling people to go home.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Which happens. That's kind of a known thing, especially if the person's going to, be dangerous or screw up the equilibrium of the group.
On Everest one year, I had I roomed with him for most of the time. He was a personal injury lawyer from LA who bragged about, he couldn't decide which color of his Lamborghinis he liked more, the red one or the blue one. And he never made it through the ice fall, and just yelled at everybody about how incompetent the guys were. And they even put him on oxygen to leave base camp. He went home early. So Will, bring us home. A couple of questions, and then we'll wrap it up. What surprised you the most? And I want to position this in a way of saying, did you have a preconception? And I know you did what journalists are supposed to do. You follow the story, let the facts take you. But what preconception that you have prior to getting into this book about climbing Everest and the industry that was changed dramatically?
I think that, like everybody, I was skeptical of whether the decisions being made, and, you know, over the years and some of the client vetting, the decisions on the mountain itself, that there was going to be some questionable things popping up. I thought that maybe, you know, morality or whatever would slip a little when it came to trying to keep a business afloat, that I was, you know, sort of all these years led to believe that there was a lot of pressure to get people to the top, right? So that surely these guides who are making X amount over the 2 months have been told by their boss, the more people we get to the top, that, you know. And so I was prepared. I was prepared to sort of have to go down that road. And I was shocked at how little of that plays into climbing guided expeditions on Everest. I was, you know, other guides, trust me, would have told me about the unscrupulous decisions other guides made, not their own, but of the, you know, 50 or so guides I spoke with, they would have said, we've got a real problem here. I watched with my own eyes, this guy make this bad decision. You know, this person didn't summit the year before, and so they had to summit this year, and so they did this thing wrong. I would have found that stuff. There's just no way it could have stayed hidden. And I didn't. I mean, there were some, you know, they were tiny, just like in life itself, you know.
Yes.
But there was really very little of that. That was surprising.
Another thing I think that you mentioned to me, and this may be out of the blue, but that if you go talk to the typical Western guide owner company, they'll talk about how the Nepali companies run an unsafe operation. And there's some data that correlates the number of deaths going with low-cost operators. There is a significant correlation there.
Yeah.
That's not to be argued. But by the way, there's also low-cost Western operators.
Yeah.
So, but they will tell you that the Nepali operators are not as good as the Western operators. What did your research result in, and what's your opinion now after working on this book for a number of years?
You know, that was that cultural piece that I try to comment on as little as possible, because it's almost impossible to understand the cultural difference between the way a Western mountain guide sees the responsibility of a guide versus the way a Nepali guide does is just a massive culturally different thing. And in this Western culture that we're from, this wide, wide margin of error, we give everything from driving to, you know, smoking to, you know, all the things that are bad for us, is just part of our culture. And Western mountain guides, with the crazy training that they do, it's pretty remarkable to hear them talk about just what they would be willing and not willing to allow. And I mean, they would not be willing to allow much. Let's put it that way. Everything is the margin of error is huge. The risk is very low in all the decisions they make. And and in Nepali culture, I think that it's just different. It's not worth. It's not better.
I was discussing a death of a climber one year with the owner of a Nepali company, and he said, "Alan, it's not our job to turn the client around." And I was discussing that with Guy Cotter, and he said, "Alan, that is our job, is to turn the client around."
So absolutely their job. Yeah.
It's a whole different framing in how, you know, how they view, you know, what their role is. And again, I don't think you would have Ryanair say it's not our job to get the, you know, our passenger alive to the, you know, to their destination. So there is a, you know, analogies start to fall apart here.
Yeah. Well, you know, and again, I think that one thing to notice about, I've had similar conversations with Nepali guides and owners but not only is it not about, because look, there are zero instances when a Sherpa guide, a well-trained, you know, experienced Sherpa guide, doesn't at least attempt to turn someone around if they're ill-suited to go on, or if they know that there's going to be a problem. I mean, I don't know. I don't think I've heard of any instance where they just literally turn around and walk away from their client. I think it begins with them saying, "This is not going well. It's time to turn around." And there's a little argument. And unlike the Western guide, the Nepalis go more hands off.
And I think that's changing dramatically.
You think so? That's interesting to hear that. I think you could be right. Like, I that makes sense. That would be-
a handful of years ago, there was a young Sherpa who was put in charge of guiding a man from Turkey to the summit, and they got in trouble. The client was going too slowly. The young Sherpa guide gave up all of his supplemental oxygen, tried to turn the man around. He refused. They both collapsed right beneath the summit. They were rescued by very, very strong, very professional, brave Sherpas that got them both down. The young man lost all of his fingers, and the client went home and told everybody how he was abandoned and he had to summit by himself. So you talk about the prima donnas and the unfair stories, and stories like that are rarely, light shone on them to show the unfairness actually in a situation like that. And how, and I mean, there's story after story after story of Sherpas. You know, there was a great story last year where a Malaysian got in trouble near the summit, and one of the Sherpas literally put him in his backpack and carried him down from the balcony on his back. I mean, that's unheard of. I mean, there's only a handful of Western guys that could do that. There's probably a house full of Sherpas that could do that are strong enough. So again, full acknowledgement of the contribution that those guys make to the industry. Last question. What's your takeaway from the book? Or what do you want? Or maybe another way of saying, what do you want the readers take away from the book to be?
Oh, geez. that I haven't touched on. Well, You know, I do think that I do think that, well, I mean, bottom line is I think there's a lot to be celebrated about, you know, what goes on within the Everest guiding industry. And I think at one time it was worth celebrating the fact that these intrepid guides like even built this industry to begin with is kind of remarkable. But then all the people like you who set this huge goal for themselves, right? It's a much bigger deal for someone like you to decide to go climb these mountains than it is for a climber who lives out of their truck, and that's what they do all the time, right? That's just the bottom line. It's a much bigger deal for us to step out of our comfort zone. I mean, you're a really outdoorsy guy, but it's major, right? To go climb an
Oh,
8,000 meter.
absolutely. Yep.
And I think that's pretty remarkable. And again, I'll just put it in the category of doing an Ironman or something. That's cool. And then that era is going away a little bit. The Western companies are disappearing. You talked about the new Western companies, the big ones. You're right about that, right? Alpenglow, Furttenbach. But the thing is, the
Madison
older,
Mountaineering, climbing the seven says Mike
yeah,
Campbell.
Matt Madison, right? But the older ones have like seven clients, three clients. I mean, they're almost non-existent, right? IMG, I think, is doing okay, but not great. I understand, I think Eric is rethinking his business model. I do. I'd almost think that Todd, I'm not even sure that he'd be rethinking it, because I think he has his business model, and that's what he wants to stick to, and stick to AAI's legacy is maybe the way to go, even if it is only a couple clients. But anyway, the other surprise or is just how uplifting it is to look at the industry today. Like, I know it's still messy. I know there's still dysfunction, and I know there's going to be arguments about morality constantly every year. But it's just cool to see it in the hands of Sherpas and Nepalis. It's cool to see that, love them or hate them, it's cool to see that the most famous mountaineer possibly in the world right now is Nepali, Nimsdai. I just think that's great to see,
Yeah.
Even Conrad Anker, talks about how, Nepal doesn't have like a cricket team to compete against Pakistan or whatever. They don't, there's not a lot in that kind of arena where they take a lot of pride. Mountaineering is one of those places where they do. And I love that it's come full circle and that it's their industry now.
Well, congratulations on, I fully agree with all of that. So congratulations on the book. I was honored to be able to, do some a little bit of a research with you or help you on some of it. So I've gotten a chance to read the book, and it is a fantastic read. Even if you're a hater of Everest, this is a book that you should read, because it's going to open your eyes up to how it got to the point where it is today. And to your point, the joy that is coming out of the industry today, in spite of the negativity and the problems. I don't know any industry, from steel making to cars to cruise boats that don't have problems. Every industry has its issues. But there's something unique about mountaineering that celebrates the individual personal spirit. And I think you've captured how that guides champion and enable individuals, people like me, that are to do something they never ever dreamed of doing. So well done on the book. Everest Inc., tell us when it's coming out and where people can get it.
Yeah, I think April 16. Tuesday, April 16 is the launch day. Obviously, it's available for pre-order at all the usual spots, but April 16th, you can actually get your hands on it in bookstores and whatnot.
I know it's on Amazon right now, available for pre-order.
Yeah,
So, all
exactly.
right, Will, congratulations and thanks for taking the time today. Best of
And
luck with the book.
thanks for all your help on the project, Alan. I mean, I honestly, when I made my list of people that, I kind of needed on board to do this, you were one of them. I sort of needed certain people, you know what I mean, to help guide me with that institutional. I mean, you've been doing this for so long, and so I appreciate that.
Well, thank you very much. You're very kind. All
Yeah.
right. Take care, man.
Have a great one.